It was Harmony Day yesterday. The rest of the world knows it as International Day for Elimination of Racial Discrimination. And when many Australians face racism on a daily basis, we call it Harmony Day. Why is the word racism so confronting for us?
Yeah, indeed it is. And Professor Larissa Behrendt, who's the Director of Research at the Jumbunna Institute at Sydney's University of Technology, is calling it out. In fact, that's the name of a new online register that she's launched to drive systemic change. And Professor Behrendt joins us now. Professor Larissa, how are you? Thanks for joining us. Can you tell us what is the call out?
Great to see you both.
Can you tell us what is the call out register?
So,
and also, how does the register be different to all the other processes that are out there?
Well, it's precisely because racism is such a big part of the lived experience of First Nations people, but the formal mechanisms for reporting it, for dealing with it, are complex, and the definitions of racism they use are very narrow. So a lot of us have experiences that we don't have an avenue to record or tell our stories. So a big part of the idea of the racism register is to have a place where mob can go to log their experiences. And it could be that there is no formal avenue, or it could be that a person who experiences racism doesn't want to have to confront the people and the institution that has created that toxic environment. So what we're hoping to do is to give a space so that these instances don't go unreported.
Larissa, it was launched during Harmony Day, and Greens Senator Lydia Thorpe, she registered the first report of racism on the register. What was the Greens Senator calling out?
Well, she was calling out her own experiences of how she's been treated as a First Nations woman in Parliament and the racism that she's incurred, particularly online. It was fantastic to see her take the lead in this to show that there is a place for people. No matter how high profile or what kind of platform you think they might have, there is still an experience that we all have of having those experiences of racism silenced, or us not having a place in which we can call it out. So we were really pleased that she led the way, and in just the first 24 hours, we've had almost 40 complaints registered on the site.
Wow.
Well, you mentioned that you're going to, you've received 40 complaints already through the register. What happens next with this information?
Well, what's important is that we're getting a kind of snapshot of things that, as I said, aren't reported. So what we're hoping is a part of this is dealing with the underreporting of racism. It's much more prevalent in our lives as First Nations people than the formal recordings would show if you looked at where complaints are made. It will allow us every year to give a bit of a snapshot. We're basing this register on experiences of the Jewish community in calling out anti-Semitism and the Muslim community in calling out Islamophobia. So what we know from their experiences is it will give us a broader range of showing the kinds of racist experiences that people are having, the places in which they're occurring, and we can monitor that year by year. So our intention is to give an annual report that feeds back those experiences. We hope in the long run this can help us target some education programs, as well as validating people who are experiencing these things and just not being heard.
Larissa, will the public be able to go on the register and see what's being reported?
There's a confidentiality around that, so they can see a range of statistics that are de-identified. But it's a good question about how the broader public can get involved, because not only is this a register for people who've experienced racism, but there is the ability for you to get on if you've witnessed racism. So people can be very proactive about calling racism out.
Larissa, just on another note, I saw you recently at the All About Women Festival at the Opera House. You were facilitating a panel, and with so many writers' festivals touring around the country now and incredible First Nations authors being given platforms to speak and being published, I can't help but feel that there is a movement at the moment in this country that's empowering women and marginalised voices. Are you experiencing that? Are you witnessing that? And how can we turn it into real change?
I love this question, and I think it actually is. I feel that way myself as well. It feels like there's a renaissance, and I think we really have to acknowledge the work that's been done by the sort of generation that's been slightly before this moment, who have called out festival directors who didn't program First Nations voices, or when they did would have one panel on First Nations writing or, you know, First Nations ideas, as opposed to actually integrating our voices throughout the program. Through the work of people like Arnie Rhoda Roberts at the Opera House and Wesley Enoch through Sydney Festival, I think the bar's been set really high. And of course, the wonderful thing about this is that there is just a plethora of fantastic voices, particularly women's voices, that we know in our community are there and we listen to, but it gives us the opportunity to take those voices broadly. And I hope we can build on that. We are seeing the arts and the storytelling and the national narrative within this country dramatically change, as we've seen a rise in the profile of Indigenous storytellers in fiction, in film, but also in music and across the performing arts.
And Larissa, you are leading the way. It's been such an honour to yarn with you on The Point tonight. Thank you for your time.